as I acknowledge already the presence of Eleanor and Mark, and each of you present within the church, bringing to mind family members and friends, all of us do so as they, as a couple, embrace God's blessing on this, their day, their wedding day. A blessing that unfolds very simply in the sacraments we celebrate, the Eucharist and marriage. And we bring to mind those unable to be present, those whose Spirit watches over us this day, trusting that they are very much with us. We acknowledge in life to where they are at this moment in time. Many people in various walks of life have guided them to this moment, none more so than their respective families. That guidance has unfolded in many ways, inspired through one's belief and faith in God. And they will both now come as a couple to acknowledge that light as they embrace God's light, acknowledging appreciation and thanks, and that that same light will be with them in the future, as they will both now come to the altar.
First reading, a reading from the book of Ruth. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God too. Whenever you die, I will die, and there shall I be buried beside you. We shall be together forever and ever, and our love will be the gift of God. This is the word of the Lord.
The second reading, a reading from the first letter of St. John. My dear people, let us love one another, since love comes from God, and everyone who loves is begotten by God and knows God. Anyone who fails to love could never have known God, because God is love. God's love for us was revealed when he sent into the world his only Son, so that we could have life through him. This is the love I mean, not our love for God, but God's love for us when he sent his Son to be the sacrifice that takes our sins away. My dear people, since God has loved us so much, we too should love one another. No one has ever seen God, but as long as we love one another, God will live in us, and his love will be complete in us. This is the word of the Lord.
To Mark and Eleanor, you have come to this church of St. Oliver Plunkett, so that the Lord may seal your love in the presence of I and among family members and friends, God's community on earth. Christian marriage is a sacred union which enriches natural love. It binds those who enter to be faithful to each other forever. It creates between them a bond that endures for life and cannot be broken. It demands that you love and honor each other, that you accept from God the children God may give you, and bring them up in the spirit of his love. To help you in your understanding of marriage as husband and wife, may you receive this day the lifelong grace of the sacrament. To you both, is this your understanding of marriage?
It is.
I declare and invite you, before God and all of us present, his church, your consent to become husband and wife.
I, Mark, take you, Eleanor, as my wife, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, all the days of our lives.
I, Eleanor, take you, Mark, as my husband, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, all the days of our lives.
Eleanor, wear this ring as a sign of our faithful love in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Mark, wear this ring as a sign of our faithful love in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Lord, and we praise you for bringing us to this happy day. You have given us to each other. Now, together, we give ourselves to you. We ask you, Lord, make us one in our love. Keep us one in your peace. Protect our marriage. Bless our home. Make us gentle. Keep us faithful. And when life is over, unite us again, when parting is no more, in the kingdom of your love. There we will praise you in the happiness and peace of our eternal home. Amen.
Mark, would you kiss your good wife, please?
That the Lord who has brought them to this happy day will keep them forever in fidelity and love. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For the parents of Eleanor and Mark, for their friends and all who have helped them to become husband and wife, Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For all who are victims of injustice and for those deprived of love and affection, Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
That the Lord may bless the world with his peace and the protection of his love. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Lord, we are blessed today to be gathered for a happy occasion. Let us not forget those who are sick, lonely, or struggling in today's world. May they be strengthened by God's love and support. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For the faithful departed, and especially for those whom we've loved, that God will one day unite us again. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Wrought with golden and silver light, the blue and the dim and the dark cloths of night and light and the half light. I would spread the cloths under your feet, but I, being poor, have only my dreams. I have spread my dreams under your feet. Tread softly, because you tread on my dreams.
To acknowledge the thanks on his presence as we share this day, this special moment in this special occasion in the lives of Eleanor and Mark. In light of everything that is unfolding within and around us locally, nationally and internationally, we acknowledge and appreciation in the light of the decision and decisions they've made today and to be celebrated, and to compliment them both amidst the challenges that placed before them, the trust that they will be well, capable, and will truly live life amidst many other challenging moments and the highs and lows of daily life. And as you gracefully walk through these challenges, no doubt life will be very good to you both. So I compliment you both personally for what? Where you are today, and trusting where life will take you, and no doubt inspired by the charisma of your respective families, life will indeed be very good to you both.
Pick up when I go. I take a left to go. everywhere I go, you'll be my home. I'll take a love to go. No matter where I go, you'll be my home. I'll take a love to go.
Thank you. just start off by welcoming everyone here today. I know what actually happened. Who would have thought it? Gare got married. Mental. Someone married Gare is what I should have said. So the first speech today is going to be by a man who bet me once at pool and has been living out in it since, and I'm going to hammer him the next time we're in Uncle Tom's. So I'm going to pass you over to Shay, who's going to do the first speech.
Thank you very much, Shay.
Well, it says good afternoon, but good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Eleanor's dad, Shay, or Seamus, whichever you prefer. And on behalf of my wife, Maeve, I'd like to start by welcoming you here today and to thank you for joining in the celebration of Eleanor and Mark's wedding. It means a lot to all of us, and we really hope you have an enjoyable evening. There's one person missing today that Eleanor would love to have here. That's her grandmother, Phyllis. And although she isn't here, she wishes Eleanor and Mark every happiness. I am so delighted to be able to welcome Mark into the Haughey family at last. As some of you may know, I'm a keen follower of sport, and I'm still playing sport at my old age. So it's a real bonus for me to be gaining a son-in-law who is also involved in all sports related. As a matter of fact, he introduced me to some new water sports when we spent a lovely few days over in Mayo with Michael and Mary during the summer. I just need to go and get some decent wetsuit gear. And you know, it's also very useful that Mark is a physiotherapist. I can have him on call if I get injured, especially now that I'm advancing in years. But you know, I actually can't remember a time when we were getting to know Mark, because from the moment we met him, he slotted in so easily into the family, and I know he and Eleanor are going to make a great team going forward. Now to Eleanor, the lady of the moment. I could talk for hours, but I promise I won't. We are fortunate to have two wonderful daughters, Eleanor and Eve. Eleanor is our eldest, and from the day she was born, one of the happiest days of our lives. From her earliest days, she has always known her own mind, and she likes everything to be just so. You could say she does things her way. And that reminds me of one school sports day I will never forget. Eleanor, with all the other girls in her class, was lined up to take part in a sprint jersey race. Now, the object of the race was to put on a jersey as fast as you could and race to the finish line. But Eleanor was having none of that. She decided that she was going to take her time. She put on the jersey very properly, but then she decided to roll back the sleeves very neatly. She fixed the collar. She flattened out all the creases. And if that wasn't bad enough, she whipped off the hairband and readjusted the hair. And when she was happy enough with her appearance, she decided to get back into the race. What race? It was long, long over. And not a lot has changed over the years. She still likes things done correctly. Eleanor is a wonderful daughter and a great sister to Neve. Well, most of the time anyway. Maeve and I are extremely proud of her, and it makes us so happy to see her looking so radiant and happy here today. It's been a bit of a bumpy road these past few months, but thank God we all made it here today. I'd like to finish with a line suggested to me by Eleanor's mum, Maeve. and it's taken from a Bruno Mars song. Hold on. Or so I'm told. And you'll be glad to hear I'm not going to attempt to sing it. However, it sums up. How we feel about Eleanor. So Eleanor, we think you're amazing just the way you are. I was afraid of that line. And that just leaves me with one final thing to do. So I'll ask you all to join me in raising your glasses to toast the future happiness of Eleanor and Mark. To Eleanor and Mark. Thank you very much, everyone, and I hope you enjoyed the evening.
I do not think anyone guessed that Shay was going to quote Bruno Mars today, but it was very fitting. The hippest dad in the country, what? Now we're going to go over to Mark's dad, and I really hope he lives up to his nickname and rips the absolute piss out of his son here now. So I'll pass you over to Mick.
Thanks, Darren. It's all downhill from here. For those who don't know me, my name's Michael, and or Mick, and I'm Mark's dad. I'm sure you will agree with me. Everybody here today, don't they two make a very handsome couple? Yes. 35 years ago, Mary and I had our own wedding reception here at this beautiful venue. And as I said in my groom speech all those years ago, on behalf of my first wife and I, I would like to welcome you here to Bellingham Castle. I'm delighted to see many friends and family members here today to share on this wonderful occasion, despite the ravages of COVID. There have been some anxious times for Mark and Eleanor, particularly in recent weeks, when there was a risk to further reduction in numbers. And yes, we got here. Yeah. I wish to welcome all our guests that have travelled long distances, such as Darver, Drumiskin and Blackrock. Note to self, please do not mention those who have travelled from outside the Pale, such as the United States, the UK, Dublin, and definitely not Donegal. We'd like to sincerely thank all those who were involved in the wedding today, particularly Father Parrick. He played a stormer, by the way. I thought he was good. Absolutely. And all those that have contributed to making this a memorable day for Eleanor, Mark and our families. Mark is the first grandchild on either side of the Geraghty MacDonald family to be married. I wish to acknowledge the grandparents that made it here today. Mark's granny, Granny MacDonald, and Granny and Granda Geraghty. I too also wish to mention Eleanor's granny, Granny MacDonald, who couldn't be with us today. A few words about Mark. As Mark was the first grandchild on both sides, you could say he was a bit of a novelty. And certainly was a novelty to his inexperienced mum and dad, that's for sure. As a young boy, there was never a dull moment when Mark was about. He was certainly a live wire. We regularly recall incidences. For example, when we moved house from Glenwood back to the Rock, on the day of the move, he decides to drive a bamboo stick up through the roof of his mouth and ended up in casualty. There are those here present today who still recall him peddling his little toy green tractor, buck naked in the tide at the priest beach, and he was 16 at the time. That's a joke. It was his first day in junior infants when he hooked up with his partner in crime and lifelong friend, Mark McGurran. Moving into his teenage years. Yeah, we had many memorable days watching Mark play sport, whether it was wearing the green of Geraldine's, the black and white of Dundalk, the blue of Leinster, the blue of Leinster, or the green of Ireland. These days will live long in the parents' memories. We've also great memories, too, of fun-packed holidays in Mayo, Costa del Sod, or otherwise known as Buddy's Dream, and plenty more good times to share, God willing. I'm sure there will be references in a later speech to his off-the-field exploits, but I'll leave that to others to expand on. Moving on to Eleanor. On behalf of the Eleanor family, I wish to officially welcome our new daughter, Laura Eleanor, into the family. Albeit she's been a member of our family long before now, and to be honest, we treat her as one of our own, and we simply love her to bits. Mark is truly a lucky guy to have such a beautiful soul as Eleanor in his life. And Mary and I can only wish both of you all the happiness in the world in your future lives together. Now, on a lighter note, I wish to offer some advice to the groom. Now, a few anecdotes, and for all you car enthusiasts out there, these have come from the Heinz Guidebook to Marriage. Number one, when the wife says, "We need to talk," what she really means, "You need to listen." When the wife says, "No, there's nothing wrong," what she really means is, "You're in a whole heap of trouble." It was at this point I was asked to shorten my speech, and I wonder why. Now, we all know there's impressive sporting genes of one sport or another on both sides of the family, including one of those very and very rare and often spoken about 1957 Louth or Lyle medals. So the expectations will be very high in terms of the calibre of the future offspring, whether it's Gaelic, soccer, rugby, cycling, tennis, swimming, or kneeboarding, which is a family joke. Hopefully, both Mary and I will be fighting over grandparenting duties with Shay and Maeve in the not-too-distant future. And finally, friends and family, please join me in a toast. Let's raise our glasses to the bride and groom. May they be blessed with the joy and happiness all the days of their lives. To the bride and groom. Thanks, guys.
Come on, Mick. Right, so we've a treat for you next. The groom's going to have to say something. So we're going to pass you over to Mark, Gair, Ape, Monkey, Gorilla. Forgotten any good shirt? Anything else, my guy?
New Jersey.
Anyone else remember any of the names we called them?
Gobshite.
Gobshite, I've been told. So to the groom, Mark Gairdy.
Thanks, lad. I'm still pulling myself together after those few speeches. Yeah, Jesus. First of all, good evening to everyone, and on behalf of my wife and I, I'd like to finally welcome you all here to Bellingham Castle to share in our very special day. I'd like to start by giving a special thanks to the staff here at Bellingham Castle, to Kira, to John, to Patrick, to the whole crew. You have been nothing but fantastic throughout the whole process. Through all the stress and the change of dates, you've gone above and beyond to accommodate us. I know Michael Bishop in particular has been keeping a close eye on the change of dates. So thank you very much for that, Michael. Much appreciated. A thank you to all our friends and family who've came here today, and a particular thanks for all your patience and support over the past number of months. It's been quite a difficult time, obviously, for everyone, but also for me and Eleanor trying to arrange and rearrange our wedding, so thank you very much for that. I'd like to thank Father Keenan for his wonderful service today, to Lisa, a photographer, who again has gone above and beyond and has been accommodating and understanding over the past 6 months. To Mario, our videographer, Tracy, for the wonderful flowers both here and in the church today. Martina, for our lovely cake, and a special thanks to Ellen, who's not here, but for her amazing music in the church and here in Bellingham. What a talent to be able to share with the world. I'd also like to thank our readers today and anyone else who contributed to the Mass. To Shay, to Maeve, and to Niamh, thank you so much from the bottom of my heart for welcoming me in from day one. And I thank you for sharing your amazing daughter and sister with me and with the world. We are lucky, both myself and Eleanor, that we are very close to our families and our families get on so well together. Good luck getting a word in when my mam and Maeve are having a chat. Shay and Maeve, I know you've been a massive support to Eleanor throughout the years, and that is demonstrated by how much she loves you, confides in you, and trusts you. I want to assure you, Seamus and Maeve, that for as long as I live, I will continue to care and love your daughter. We've already had some great times together, and no doubt we have many more to come. I also want to thank you guys for the love and support you've given to me and Eleanor since we've been together. For example, when we moved into 160 in Rathmount. Seamus appeared just as excited and enthusiastic as we did, and this enthusiasm led him to the grave error of suggesting that he would cut our grass until I settled down and bought my own lawnmower. Little did Seamus know that it would be a full year until I bought my own lawnmower. That is a lot of grass to cut. I am not sure when I saw Seamus happier. When I asked him for his daughter's hand in marriage, or when I told him I'd finally bought my old lawnmower. It is not lost on me how blessed I am to have my grandparents here today. And I've had them throughout my childhood and my adult life. I am honoured to call them my friends and their influence that has had a massive bearing on who I am today. My relationship with them is all extremely important to me, as well as the many memories from throughout the years. I cannot put into words how much you all mean to me. I'd also like to acknowledge Eleanor's granny Phyllis, who couldn't make it here today, but I know that holds a very special place in Eleanor's heart. I'd also like to acknowledge those who couldn't be with us here this evening, who are watching down on us today, my late grandfather Jimmy and Auntie Trace, and Eleanor's grandparents James, Patrick and Bridget. I'd also like to acknowledge the absence of a dear old friend of mine, Pádraig McKeown. I'd like to raise a toast to them all. Nearly there. To my own parents, I have nothing but massive, massive love and thanks. The love, support and patience. Lots of patience you've shown to me, Michelle and Eleanor throughout the years, or to Matthew, can never be repaid. I have nothing but fond memories of my childhood, memories that I'll have for life. Nothing was ever too much of an ask, from travelling around the country for rugby games, to support your academic endeavours, or just for a friendly chat. Lots of people, when asked who their inspirations or their heroes are in life, like to list famous people from around the world. I did not have to look too far for my heroes in life. I cannot thank either of you enough. Dad, a man of few words, your actions speak louder than any words, and you have been and continue to be a massive inspiration to me throughout my life. If I turn out to be a tenth of the man that you are, I will be happy with my lot. Ma'am, as much as I like to slag you, I've slowly come to the realisation that I take after you in more ways than one. I am still undecided on how I feel about that. I'm only messing. You're one of the most kind-hearted people, and the kind-hearted people I've ever known, and your unconditional love and support means the world to me and to Eleanor. I'm lucky to consider you both among my best friends. To Michelle, my favourite sister, and Matthew, my favourite brother. I'm blessed to have such a close relationship with you both. Michelle, we grew up in each other's pockets, and I'm delighted I will soon be welcoming a new brother-in-law into the family. Joe. Despite your horrendous taste in whiskey, we'll be glad to have you. Matthew, it's an honour to have you here standing by my side today, and your courage, drive and your moral compass inspires me daily. Lord knows I need that moral compass with some of the company that I keep. To the wonderful bridesmaids who are looking absolutely spectacular today. Fair play to you girls. Thank you so much for the help and support you've shown to Eleanor, not just over the past few months, but throughout her life. I know she values your friendship massively. Particular thanks for keeping the spirits high over the last 6 months or so. It means a lot. To the own motley crew I've assembled here today, McGar, Slab and Moan, your friendships mean the world to me. We've been through so much together throughout the years, some brilliant memories and some memories I very much like to forget. I'm honoured to have you here by my side today, and also to have a wide group of close-knit friends that you know you can call on and rely on at any time. And Paul Myrna. And last but not least, the main event of the day, my beautiful bride, Eleanor Geraghty. My good friend Slab texted me about 2 weeks ago out of the blue and said, "You know, Ger, do you ever just stop and think to yourself, how on God's earth did you convince someone to marry you?" I share the same disbelief as you, Darren. I cannot believe my luck. Not only, Eleanor, are you the most beautiful person in the world, you're the most genuine, caring and selfless person I have ever met. You mean the absolute world to me, and I cannot wait to see what our future holds together. I will never forget watching you walk down the aisle towards me today. If we can get through the last 6 months, we'll get through just about anything. I want you to know that I will spend the rest of my days devoted to loving you and making you feel happy. And I promise you that I will put just as much work into our relationship as you do to keeping our floors clean. I'd like to raise a glass to my new wife, Eleanor Geraghty.
I think we can all agree that none of us expected that, and we'll find out later who actually wrote the speech, because there was no way it was Geraghty. And one thing, will you stop blaming your poor grandparents for the way you turned out? Before we go any further, we've just a couple of cards to read out from people who couldn't make it today for various reasons, or one reason, COVID. So the first one is from a fella from Australia. He's not from Australia, he's in Australia, Fergal Carroll. "My stories for Mark are completely and utterly inappropriate for this special setting and beautiful bride. I wish nothing but eternal love for the two of you and have the best, most memorable day. Cheers to the Sandy Lane Shuffler, Fergal." Then we have a man from who's living in Chile now, and just a nice simple message from Kieran O'Rourke to say best wishes to a wonderful life together, Kieran O'Rourke. We then have Ed McGuire, who's gone a different path. "Have a wonderful day and a wonderful life together, and I hope your first dance is as wonderful as the Ballymac Arena Mark performed for me out in the Ballymac when I shouted four. P.S. If you've any money left after the wedding, will you buy some fucking light bulbs?" And now we have a 12-page essay. You will probably guess who this is from. Johnny McGailey has something to say, ladies and gents. "So, Gare and Eleanor, I'm sure all your guests are expecting me to pop out from behind the curtain, but let's put the nail in that coffin. I'm writing this in Watego Beach in Byron Bay, Australia. It's 27 degrees, I have a can in my hand, probably a cocktail, let's be honest. And I'm watching Dan O'Kelly's goal on repeat, probably Love Island. I'm on me holidays. I would love nothing more to be up there with you all. Beach days are great, but missing days like this are tough. Gero, you've done very well. Great job, new house and marrying a teacher. It's hard to believe that you actually ended up like this, based on who you are as a person." He also never admitted to smashing a window in our house on the last night while... Oh, jeez, I didn't read this bit beforehand. On the last night of our J1 with a men's sexual aid. That's all I'm saying. And still, Mary Geraghty believes the sun always shines at a Mark's rear. And it always will, Mary. In Mark, though, Eleanor has a complete team player, a man with whom during town to town without him, town to town would never have happened. A man who all those clubs in Wicklow and Dublin were not playing. Liar, he got paid for every one of them. Him to play 3 games over 3 years due to injury. But in all seriousness, Gary, you're loyal to the bone, a genuine building fan, brilliant friend, and Eleanor, you've found an amazing wife, and I'm incredibly excited for your future together. I cannot wait to get home and see you both as the Garrities. Have an amazing day, everyone. I'm sure Mark has put on a free bar for you. he did a joke in it anyway. Love from Oz, now and always, Johnny McGailey. I'd say you're all starving after McGailey's speech. But I'm going to pass you over to the man who has literally spent his life waiting for this moment. The man who misses nothing and says nothing. Mark Gordon Ramsay McGarrion has got some shit to stir.
Thanks, Slab. Hi all, as Slab said, I'm Mark to some of you here, McGarr to probably most of the room. And today I have the honour of being Mark's best man. I hope we all had a lovely time so far and continue to do so. And I would like to apologise in advance if I in any way ruined that. There's actually just one announcement that Mark has asked me to make that he'd forgotten his speech. He has asked me to thank NEFID and the government for limiting the numbers today. he told me during the week that he was delighted with the limited numbers and that it saved him a fortune. Just something to bear in mind for the duration of this speech is that Gary has somewhat of a reputation as being a wee bit tight with the wallet. Myself, I would think it's a harsh reputation, but some below, like Big Nick Myrna, would think it's not harsh enough. Quick word on the bridesmaids. Every single one of you look absolutely stunning today. And speaking of single, Mickey Bone, over here to my right, has asked me to tell you and to the wider room that he is also single. If any, you just want to keep that in mind later on. You will have to share your shampoo in the morning, that's the only thing. I was born on the 21st of January 1988, and the first few days of my life were fucking brilliant. Liverpool were winning regularly, Brexit wasn't a thing, and neither was Donald Trump. Then 3 days later, Mark Geraghty was born, and all our lives would change forever. Our mothers met at a prenatal class, and it's fair to say that we've been good friends ever since. Once us two Egypts were born, they regularly met up in each other's houses for coffee. And this is where I first got acquainted with Mark Geraghty. It's fair to say that he was always slightly different to the other kids. I just could never really communicate it. And when I finally could talk, one of the first things I asked my mother was, why does the other Mark always take his clothes off and run around naked? And honest to God, if I had a euro for every time someone has asked me that over the last 30 years, I'd be a very rich man. He doesn't do it anymore, Eleanor assures me. The next part of our journey took us to Rose's Play School, where we ran amok, and then we went on to the dreaded big school. I was like most four-year-olds at the time, excited but nervous about what would await me. But I assured myself that all would be well because I had my best mate with me, and he'd look after me no matter what. A few days in, I realised he would be the lad I needed to be protected from. One of our first days in school, we sat at the table to have lunch, and as per usual, Gary absolutely horsed all his lunch into him in record time. But he was still hungry. He angrily suggested I give him my lunch, which I politely declined, and I went back to my sandwich. A couple of seconds later, Gary closed his lunchbox, picked it up, and absolutely smashed into the side of my face. A wrestle ensued, and we both found ourselves down in the principal's office getting an earful off Mr. McKenna. It wouldn't be the last time he got me into trouble or give me an injury. I've only ever broken one bone, and I also had surgery one other time, and Mark Geraghty was a central figure in both incidents. Only went to secondary school, the De La Salle. Again, some great days were had here. It was in secondary school where Gertie's sporting talents really came to the fore. Whatever sport he played at, he excelled, whether it be on a rugby pitch where he represented Leinster and Ireland on occasion, or Gaelic where he represented Louth all the way to minor. His memorable moments on the sporting pitches weren't always memorable for the right reasons though. He was in fact a member of the Louth minor squad which lost a championship game to Kilkenny of all teams. Fucking Kilkenny, Jesus. He was also prone to do some unbelievable things on a GAA pitch. I do recall one championship game in Cooley one night, and we were down a couple of points at half time. But no matter, Gertie would see us through. He'd do something, he'd get it out of this mess. We lined up in midfield for the second half. As usual, he rose highest to pluck the ball clean out of the sky and took off towards the goals. And as usual, nobody could stop him. The only issue was, though, he had forgotten we'd switch sides at half time. He proceeded to launch the ball into the square, where the Cooley full forward gladly accepted this gift and buried it into the back of the net. A goal we would not recover from, and yet another championship had went to begging. The next stages of our life was college, and this is where Gertie really started to come into his own. I can assure you a degree in sports science and physiotherapy was not the only thing that man learned in college. Himself and Mickey Moan got up to all sorts of DCU. There was frequent trips out to Maynooth where I was studying. And and he introduced me to this game, new game he had. It was called Musbies. I don't know the origins of the game or who came up with it or what, but it was few as skilled at his mark, Gertie. I won't go into too much detail on what the game itself, but if you've ever been out and a drink that you have had has mysteriously disappeared, then it's more than likely this man has had something to do with it. During the college years, we used to meet down at Knuckle Tom's, or Harrison's, that was called most Fridays, to shoot the breeze and talk shite. One Friday he texted me to say he couldn't make it. He spent all his money in college. I don't really know exactly what he spent it on, because it definitely was not drink. However, 30 minutes later, he texted to say he had money to meet me there at 9 o'clock. He arrives down anyway and orders a pint. And I asked him where did he get the money. And straight face, he replied to me, Matthew's piggy bank. He did try to quantify this by saying that you would need it or you would never miss it. I have no idea over the years how many trips he took to that piggy bank. Another one of these Fridays, we overdone it. Had one too many. I woke up the next day an awful head of me. And I texted Gertie to ask him how he was. He said he was absolutely dying. He said he got up that night and got sick. Only problem was he couldn't make it to the toilet. So he got sick into the sports bag. I said you'll have good fun cleaning that, which he replied with laughing faces saying I'll be doing no such thing. He formulated a plan which he executed to military precision. His plan was that he would not clean it up. He would sleep with the bag beside him for 2 days. He did not want Mary and Mick knowing that he'd overdone it, so he slept with the bag for 2 days in his room. And then he went down in the Monday morning. And gingerly went up to Mary and said, oh Mary, I was feeling ill during the night and I got sick into my bag. Mary, feeling sorry for her absolute angel of a son, offered to clean it, which he gladly accepted.
One day.
During the college year, that wasn't the only time he was a wee bit disgusting, to be honest with you. Back in 2008, a crew of us headed over to San Francisco to live it up for the summer. Towards the end of this holiday, we decided to go on a 2-week road trip. Gertie, being as organised as he is, decided that he would do all his washing well in advance. He came in and proudly told everybody that all his washing was done, all his clothes were washed, and he was ready for a road trip. Again, there was a problem. We had 8 days to go before we went on this road trip. I asked him what his plan was, what is he going to wear for the next 8 days? And he said, what was on him? Boxers included. There was 15 of us sitting in this dorm room. It's a sweaty, real warm dorm room. And for the next 8 days, unfortunately for all of us, he was a man of his word. He wore the boxers, inside out, upside down, east to west, you name it, he wore it. And he absolutely stank. I don't even know if he had a shower, because I'm pretty sure he did not want to dirty his towels. Back to the present. And as you'd probably say himself, he's too old for Mosby's now. But it hasn't stopped him learning a few new tricks. When he now goes to weddings, he hovers over the... His new plan of attack is to hover around the father of the groom, as he suspects they'll be loose with their wallets. And unfortunately for you, Mick, there's a few lads in here calling in their family debt. There's one constant in Mark Gerry's life, and that's dancing. He's always been shite. But 10 out of 10 for enthusiasm. We were actually at a wedding last year, and myself, Eleanor and all were at the bar, just getting a drink. The decision was made that we would go to the photo booth to get a photo. We decided to take a wee shortcut through the dance floor, as the band had started back up. And as you do, we were having a bit of a jig and a jive as we walked along. The security guard came over to us and had a word in my ear, and I apologised and moved on. A couple of seconds later, Mark Gerry comes up to me behind the photo booth and he says, looking as proud as punch. I asked him what he's so happy about. And he said, the security lad is after coming up to me to say that you're class on the dance floor. I shook my head and I said, no, he didn't. He said, no glass on the dance floor. A quick word about the Gerrys and the Hotties. I've known the Gerrys family all my life, and they've always had a warm, welcoming home and a great sense of family. And in the time that I've known the Hotties, I get the feeling it's the same with them. And it's easy to tell that the bride and the groom have come from loving, caring backgrounds. On to the bride. I had a feeling that you're always going to be special the night the two of you met. Unbeknownst to me at the time, you walked past me in the rum house, and you've been followed by himself, who was doing his best impression of a lost puppy. He briefly paused as he passed me and told me, she's unreal. And walked on after you. I knew something was definitely up the next morning and over the next couple of days, as there wasn't a peep out of him in the lads' WhatsApp group. A sure sign something was up. A couple of texts later, I found out what had happened. And then I dropped him into the beer keeper the following weekend, and here we are, 4 years later. Do you want to confirm that, Gary, before, yeah?
Yeah?
You're an amazing couple. Eleanor, you look absolutely stunning today, I think it's fair to say. I know how happy you make Gerry feel, and I couldn't think of anyone better for him to spend the rest of his life with. It's safe to say it's been a rocky road for you both this year, and I'm absolutely delighted that you finally get to celebrate your special day. Ger, you've been my best mate from day dot, like the brother I never had. It's been an absolute honour to stand by your side today. Eleanor, please look after him, because considering the contents of my speech, he clearly can't look after himself. I wish you both a lifetime of happiness and good health. Can I please have everyone upstanding to toast my best mate and the love of his life? To the bride and groom.
So, for my own mam, Mary, and for Maeve, Eleanor, do you want to give that to your mam? And mam, you're right, mam, it's all lies.
I love you.
It's all lies.
Think about it. There must be a higher love down in the heart, hidden in the stars above. Wasted time. Look inside your heart, I'll look inside mine. Things look so bad everywhere in this whole world. What's fair? We walk blind, we try to.
walk the line and try to see.